Is buying and fixing a 12-year-old camera worth the effort? Well, that's what we're gonna find out in this video. Hello dear viewers, and welcome to the Repair Lair. I've recently purchased this old and slightly malfunctioning Fujifilm digital camera. It's from 2008, and it cost me £15. In this video, I will show you how I fixed it, as well as give you a brief overview of what kind of quality you can expect from something so old and so cheap. So let's get started. Inside the box, we've got a Fujifilm S1000 FD. I've kept the receipt. You can see that the camera cost me just £15. Gotta cover the date though, otherwise you'll know how long it took for me to get the video out. The cool thing is that the camera came bundled with all the original accessories, like the manual, the AV cable, and the original lanyard. But we don't care much about those, do we? Here's the camera itself. The backstory here is that a lovely old lady bought this camera from a charity shop and was returning it, as the screen apparently didn't work.
Strange, I know. I too had no idea that you can actually return stuff to the charity shop.
As I overheard the conversation, I asked if they wouldn't mind selling the camera to me instead of discarding it, so here we are. My apologies for the inconvenience. I must say it feels rugged and the grip is very comfy. It's just the right size for my girly hands. It's got a cheap lens cap as well as a built-in flash and the usual set of random buttons next to the D-pad. It uses standard AA batteries, which is convenient if you want to help destroy the environment. And it even came with a 2GB SD card. What a bargain. The electronic viewfinder works okay, but in reality it's slow and small. Switching to the display on the back reveals the issue. All you get is a white screen without anything being displayed.
My guess is that the camera has received a good hit, like from being dropped or something, and that the screen has got partially disconnected. Let's see if we can fix it.
Having armed myself with a set of screwdrivers and a pair of tweezers, disassembly was not very challenging. To get to the screen, the back half of the camera's housing must be taken off. The back is held on by two Phillips head screws on each side. If you take up doing repairs like this yourself, the most important advice I can give you is to make sure you keep all the screws somewhere safe. Taking out the batteries is also a good idea, which should be done first, but I forgot to do it as I was concentrating on not getting my hair in the shot. On the bottom, there's one Phillips head screw that needs to be taken out, and two security screws with triple slotted heads. Nasty. Not really a huge challenge though. I don't have the right bit, but you can brute force these screws with an appropriately sized flathead screwdriver bit. It works fine as long as the bit is small enough. I double-checked everywhere in case there were any other screws that I missed, and since no other screws were visible, the back could now be popped off pretty easily. Before disconnecting the buttons, I've powered the camera back on briefly and switched it to use the screen on powering up instead of the viewfinder. The button assembly could then be disconnected. These ribbon cables are simple to release by popping up the plastic locking tabs. The screen is held firmly in place by this thin metal frame. The spudger quickly takes care of that issue, but the frame itself is held by four screws, which must be removed to access the display connector. Removing the metal frame reveals some of the secret components that do the picture taking magic, as well as the display connector. It seems to be undamaged and still firmly connected, but I remove it anyway just to give it a good clean. I like using fiberglass pencils to clean contacts like these, but one can usually get by with some fine grit sandpaper too. Once both the cable and the socket have been cleaned, the screen can then be reconnected to see whether that fixed the issue.
Now at this point, it's likely that we're dealing with one out of two possibilities. Either the screen itself is broken, or the driving circuitry on the logic board is toast. Sadly, without having two identical cameras and being able to swap the screens around, there's no easy way of knowing which problem we're dealing with here. And let's be honest, you'd have to be pretty well off to afford two of these bad boys. However, I happen to have an oscilloscope, a device which plots voltage changes over time. Now this is bound to come in handy in taking a look at what's happening on the logic board.
Here I've got the Rigol DS1054Z with the 50 to 100 MHz bandwidth hack, just like every other self-respecting hobbyist. We're going to be using this to see what's happening on the display connector pins. To get a good reading, it's important to connect the scope's ground to some known ground on the camera. The bigger components, like the metal housing parts or heat sinks, are typically grounded, so they are a good bet to attach the scope's grounding clip. Normally, with the scope not connected to anything, all you get on the screen is a little bit of noise. By poking various things with the scope probe, we should be able to see three types of graphs. Some pins may have a constant high voltage, which would be our positive power. Other pins may have a constant zero, which would be the ground. And most importantly, some of the pins may go up and down like crazy, and that's likely where our ones and zeros carrying the image data are at. So what I want to find is at least one pin that has live data coming out of it. That will give a good indication that it's the screen that is broken and not the components on the camera's logic board. As the screen's backlight is lit, at least we can be sure that the display is getting power. Checking each pin one by one, I find this. After adjusting the scope settings, you can see that we are definitely getting some big chunks of data being sent on one of the pins, which is likely the picture data. This means that we can be reasonably certain that it's the screen that's malfunctioning. So let's see if we can get a new one. Damn, that's pretty expensive. That's like 30% of what I paid for the camera. So here's the new screen. Before doing anything, it's good to make sure that the new screen is actually the same part as the old one, and they do seem to look identical. Testing the new screen is simple. All we have to do is connect it to the camera and power it on. Now let's see if it still takes pictures after me messing with it. And it does! Well, isn't that something? Before everything is put back together, the ribbon cable on the new display must be bent correctly so that it can fit neatly behind the metal frame we took out earlier. Here I'm marking the locations of the bends and gently fold the ribbon cable into the required shape. You mustn't be rough with these things, they have fragile copper traces inside of them that can easily crack. Once the screen is reconnected, the frame can go back in too. And since I didn't bother keeping the screws sorted when disassembling, I now get to play the lovely game of let's see if the screw fits here. No less than 4 times, too. The rest is quite straightforward. The screen simply pops back into the frame once aligned correctly. And the button assembly gets reconnected. I was hoping to keep the screen protector until fully done with the reassembly, but the screen is a bit wider than the hole in the back panel, so I had to take it off. Once the shell is back together, the Phillips screws, as well as the two nasty security screws, are all placed back where they belong. After a thorough wipe, it's time to see what kind of tricks this old dog can do. Now it's a pretty nice evening today, so I decided to take the little Fuji that we repaired here out for a spin and see how well it performs. Now obviously I'm not expecting too much for something that's 12 years old and costs less than a decent meal in a restaurant, but hey, we have to take a look, don't we? But before we actually take a look at some pictures, the important question here is whether we can actually vlog with a 12-year-old camera.
And the answer to that is hell no. This thing has no settings. The best option that it records at is 64p VGA mode, which is complete garbage, as you can see. It literally has no settings already. You cannot adjust the aperture, you cannot adjust the ISO, you cannot adjust anything. You just pull
First of all, there's no flippy screen, so I have no idea what the heck I'm doing. I don't know where I framed myself. Am I even in frame? Can you see me? Who knows? Hey, you be the judge.
Now, with that out of the way, let's talk picture quality. The images produced by this camera are reasonably sharp, but the metering is not reliable. Scenes that look and are reported by the light meter to be exposed properly have consistently come out underexposed, even in manual mode. The colors feel overly saturated and don't tend to color correct well. But as this camera doesn't shoot RAW, that's not really a big surprise. But more importantly,
one thing that I really can't stand with this camera is how bad the shutter lag is. So if I frame something and I half press the shutter release and then click it in, it takes a completely different picture. You know, it's not gonna compete with pretty much anything that you can buy these days. But hey, 15 pounds, which is about as much as 10 Coke bottles if I'm not mistaken.
It also has a pretty decent macro mode, which can autofocus up to as close as a couple of centimeters. It's not bad at all. You can get some really good close-up shots, and even a little bit of a blurry background, though everything even slightly away from the middle of the frame suffers from serious chromatic aberration. At its longest zoom setting, the lens has a focal length of 70mm, which is definitely a big plus. Sadly, the camera has no optical stabilization, and the lens has a maximum aperture of f5. Add to that the fact that the image is projected onto a sensor that's about the same size as a grain of rice, and you get a combination that's far from being friendly to handheld shooting.
Would you believe if I said this thing has a panorama mode as well? Let's take a look how well that works.
And jokes aside, if you place this camera on a solid surface or use it with a tripod, take multiple shots at different exposure levels and just try hard enough, you can actually get some very decent images. But I got tired of the terrible user experience very quickly.
And that's all I have for this time. I must say, I found fixing the camera far more fun than actually trying to use it. But to be completely honest with you, it's probably not as bad as I'm making it out to be. Sure, most if not all smartphones these days can easily match and surpass the picture-taking quality of this thing. But you have to keep in mind that camera apps don't normally allow you to really change the settings all that much. This thing, on the other hand, even though it's so old and so cheap, it still gives you full manual controls over the aperture, the ISO, the shutter speed, and the focus. Which, in my opinion, makes it totally sufficient if one wants to just dip their toes into learning photography. More importantly, you can likely buy a working camera like this, or of a similar vintage, for very, very cheap. Likely cheaper than many of the toys you can buy in a toy store, which in my opinion makes it a really good gift for a kid that likes techie gadgets. Anyway, I hope you found the video useful and entertaining. Thank you so very much for watching, and I'll see you again very soon. So I just spent like 5 minutes trying to figure out how to turn on manual focus on this, and I couldn't do it. I wanted to manually focus on the building right there because it's not working with auto. And I tried every single mode on the selector switch, auto, program, shutter priority, aperture priority, manual. It just doesn't let me do it. I cannot select manual focus, because it's just grayed out and I don't know what to do, and I'm not gonna bother because it's late, I'm hungry, I'm cold, and I have better things to do. Sorry, Fuji.